In our fourth lecture, named the timelessness and the primitive connection, we are going to uncover a very interesting aspect of folk art, where sometimes we feel that folk art should be timeless in its characteristic. By the term timeless or ageless, what we basically mean is that it should not be confined to a particular time. So when we look at the examples of folk and minor art, it should not show a contemporized aesthetics. So if it's traditionally made in a particular way, it should have the same aesthetic quality throughout. But when we look at folk art and we say that they are made by people and they're for the people are also changing, and the entire civilization, the living, the habitual livelihood, they're also undergoing a lot of change. So it then remains a question that when can we really expect folk art to remain unchanged? We cannot. But then in some instances, we see that there are certain artworks which are undergoing a common worldview, and that has some common connection that is global, and that is just a condition where we see that it can be recognized from any perspective, and we do not really need any thematic or iconic connection to recognize them. And let's discuss the timelessness aspect of folk and minor art, and also try to understand why the tribal arts, which are practiced by the tribal communities, often have this characteristic, which is not undergoing any change and it's developing style wise, but there are also elements which are getting added, which are much more contemporarized. So try to assess the factor called timelessness in the context of folk and minor art in this lecture. Timelessness and primitive connection, that is the topic that we are going to discuss here. New Delhi based art historian and curator Yashodhara Dalmia found link between the prehistoric cave paintings of Vimbetka, Madhya Pradesh, and tribal worli painting of Maharashtra. In her book The Painted World of the Worlis, she claimed that the Worlis carry on a tradition which dates back to 2500 or 3000 BCE. The mural paintings of Worlis are similar to those cave paintings of Vimbetka in Madhya Pradesh. Mainstream art are generally meant to fulfill aesthetical aspects, not made for any utilitarian purpose. Unlike such mainstream art, folk art has ritualistic purpose besides aesthetics. Ancient art was also made for any functional purpose, not only for the sake of art. In this respect, there are similarities between primitive and folk art. A completely aesthetical purpose of art is, as we know, a rather recent concept. A contemporary aesthetical purpose for art is, as we know, a rather recent concept. It is only in the last few centuries that the aesthetics and functional have been condemned to isolated polarities, needing special effort as reconciliation. This is a quote by K.G. Subramanian. So in the beginning of civilization, what we see that there had been nothing called utility and aesthetics. They were together and connected. It's only very recently that we see that we have separated aesthetics from the utilitarian objects in the age of mass production. So in a way, when the primitive communities made a vase, for example, it's a pail to carry water, they also decorated that particular vessel. Now, we may always ask this question, that what is the utility of this paintings, the decoration that is made on the surface of it? And that is not an irrelevant question in that context, that if a person is struggling and walking around 6 kilometers a day to fetch a vessel full of water from a particular distance, then what inspires that particular person to decorate that particular pot? There must be some reason. Now, what is the inspiration of this creative activity? It can be something which is connected to a deep superstitious belief. It can be a ritualistic, pure ritualistic thing to make certain thing more auspicious. It can be something that changing the context, using the same object and giving it a different significance by decorating it. Whatever the purpose of art, it was something that was a practice, and it still continues in different communities. We still feel like doing a whole lot of thing that can be called as art, devoid of any utility or any particular reason for it, and we still practice that for no reason. And with that, we express ourselves, we feel good about it, and the reasons are very difficult to find out, and the psychology, the inspirations behind it is also equally difficult to decipher. So it is assumed that folk artists are continuing the primitive traditions in their works. Even the modernist mainstream artists of the West are interested in primitive art. Henry Moore, a modern Western sculptor, said, "All art has its roots in the primitive." We should also get back and see how Picasso, having been trained in a particular Renaissance aesthetics, that was something that he did in a very young age, trained by his father. He tried to find out a new definition of aesthetics that led him to drop in into a exhibition space where the Negro native artworks and the masks and other artifacts and arts were displayed. And through that exhibition, by experiencing the display, Picasso also realized that primitive aesthetics has a different definition of beauty. So beauty doesn't really mean that all beauties are connected to the standard of Renaissance, of late 15th and 16th century. And it is a realization that made the primitive art more significant in the modernist context. And as we see, the first cubist painting by Picasso, which was an abstract or semi-abstract painting, which is known to be the first attempt to an abstract painting, what he created, that is the Demoiselle d'Avignon, what we see there is he created a face there with a sculptural feature that had certain resemblance with the Negro sculptures of that time, and that was a different definition of beauty that we got to see, and that probably has started a new era. So primitive art and the ageless style had its connection that influenced modernity and operated the fiber of the understanding of modernity in a different direction. Folk art is separated from mainstream fine art. It comes under a kind of art with naive and primitive expressions. But folk art cannot be called primitive in the sense of Western concept of primitivism, which was a principle of modernity largely accepted by many Western modern artists. Unlike mainstream art, it is not a kind of art with academic sophistication. Folk art is best identified as a distinct genre. In this age of technological advancement, folk artists stick to their own techniques, which are primitive in nature. Though ready-made industrial paints are available now, sometimes folk painters like prehistoric cave painters make pigments from natural resources, leaves, rocks, charcoals, etc. We have mentioning how the Patuas made the paints and brush in Nandalal Bose's Shilpa Charcha and Gurushada Dutt's writing from the early 20th century. These techniques and materials lack sophistication of modern paintings and resemble primitivist art. So it's not the permanence of the media or the longevity of it, rather the creative expression that has dominated and inspired these people to develop their contents from certain other inspirations, social or otherwise. So whatever the reason is, what we see here is folk art and minor art is actually undergoing a lot of change, which is inevitable, and we must accept those changes when it's taking place. So primitivity is a quality, or the agelessness is a quality that is highly admired. At the same time, that should not be fixed as a criteria, and we must develop that kind of a tolerance towards the new subject matters being identified, as long as the aesthetic qualities are maintained throughout. We should always value the aesthetic qualities that is coming through the age-old traditional values and the kind of aesthetics that is sharing a common worldview. But we must not forget in this context that unless there's a change which is continuous and natural, and that gets incorporated into the artwork, it cannot leave. So when we talk about tradition, it's not just the past, but present is also going to become past one day. And continuing with the same thing over and over again may not make much of a sense in that context. So in our next lecture, we are going to talk about the issue of this evolving character and how the purpose of ritualistic art is evolving into a propagative secular purpose. In the next two lectures of our first module, we are going to discuss a very intricate issue. The understanding has to be made clear at this point, so that we get to the journey of looking, thinking and appreciating the artworks in its right relevant context. It's all about how the artworks have started as the ritualistic or customary practices and how they're evolving at creative expressions. So the evolution is all about the ritualistic to the propagative or communicative things, and we are trying to understand that into its right fiber. We will continue with our next lecture.